या यस
डाउट
हाँ
सर, आई हैव वन डाउट।
या हाँ टेल मी।
सर, इन द बुक इट वॉज रिटन दैट द कॉमन कलेक्टर कॉन्फ़िगरेशन इज यूज फॉर इम्पीडेंस मैचिंग पर्पज। सर, व्हाट इज दैट, कैन यू एक्सप्लेन प्लीज?
इम्पीडेंस मैचिंग पर्पस ओके राइट। एक्चुअली देर इज अ स्पेसिफिक एप्लीकेशन ऑफ कॉमन कलेक्टर कॉन्फ़िगरेशन ओके एंड वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एप्लीकेशन इज दिस दैट यू जस्ट आर टोल्ड इम्पीडेंस मैचिंग। इम्पीडेंस डू यू अंडरस्टैंड? If your circuit consists
So resistance, the
resistance,
effective resistance of a circuit.
Yeah, definitely. If the circuit contains reactive elements such as inductors, capacitors, along with the resistors, then the whole the complete resistance is called as impedance. Okay, so a circuit containing only resistance, we can just call this as its resistance value. But if it contains capacitors along with, we generally call it as impedance instead of resistance. Okay, so suppose if we have two circuits, let's say generally if this is the complete circuit, let's assume that I am drawing it in block wise. This is the complete circuit. Okay, any circuit, any big circuit will consist of smaller portions, smaller sub circuits. Okay, so this is sub circuit one and this is sub circuit two. Okay, you will feed the input signals, it will go here. Okay, it will produce its output signal, it will, let's say it is connected to the input side of sub circuit two and it is producing its output signals and they are going further and getting processed and you are getting some output signal here. Okay, so let's focus on this point. So if this is one circuit, small circuit, okay, which is feeding its output signal to the input side of sub circuit two, okay, and my requirement is that there should be maximum power transfer between sub circuit one and two, that is whatever power is coming from its output side should get transferred into sub circuit two input terminals. Okay, if I want this complete power transfer, maximum power transfer between two stages, this is stage one, this is stage two. Okay, and for this condition to be satisfied, that maximum power to be transferred between two stages, there is a theorem about this. Okay, and that tells that the maximum power can transfer between any two consecutive stages only when the output impedance of this, okay, the output impedance of this sub circuit one should match or should be equal to the input impedance of this sub circuit two. Okay, so let's output impedance, let's say this is output impedance of sub circuit one, okay, and this is input impedance of sub circuit two. So in this case, maximum power will transfer between two stages only when this Z01 is equal to ZI2. Okay. This is one thing, that impedance should be matching between these two stages. Okay. So it's a kind of like matching the impedance. I want to make sure the impedance at the output side of this sub circuit one is equal to the input side of this. Okay, so for this purpose this common collector configuration can be used very well. Okay, and this, the whole scenario is called as impedance matching. Okay,
yes sir.
The goal is to transfer maximum power between two stages, right? Yes, any other doubt from anyone? Okay, then let us start today. So there is one little topic left, and it's a continuation, like not continuation, but like one of the most important application of transistor. And because transistor as an amplifier we had seen yesterday. Okay, so today we will see the application of transistor as a switch. Transistor as a switch. So switch. So let us come to this first, because switches are important, very important. Switch may be on or off. Okay, any switch, any, let's say any electrical switch, if you that you use in your household, can be on or off. So it's having two state. Okay. One is on state and one is off state. Okay, and as a consequence also, for implementing digital electronics or for binary numbers, okay, we are having just 0 or 1. Okay, 0 or 1. So because of this coincidence, we can use switches to implement the digital electronics part. Okay. Okay, so I can say that I can say that. Okay, I can correspondingly call this when the switch is on. Let's say this is one state. Okay, and when the switch is off, this is zero state. Okay, in digital electronics. Okay. In digital electronics or binary numbers part. Okay, so there is a direct relation between the states of a switch and the binary number, and because of this, switches are very popular. Switches can be used directly to implement the digital electronic circuits. Okay, and that is why it's important. And one good news is that we can use transistors as a switch. It means that we can use transistors to construct digital electronic circuits. Okay, but transistor is having 4 mode. Okay, we had seen, remember that table, there was one active, forward, reverse, forward active. Okay, then reverse active, and there was one saturation mode of operation, and the last one was cutoff mode of operation. Okay, but we need just two state. We need either on or off. We need either on or off state. Okay. So out of those 4 modes of operation for transistor, we can choose the two states which are most suitable, one for on state and one for off. This FF, right? Okay. So the, let's say this is transistor is on. When it is operating in saturation region. Okay, and the condition for saturation region is that the both of the junctions are forward biased. Okay, this was the condition for saturation region of operation, saturation mode of operation, if you remember. Okay, and the transistor is in off state, that is, it is not conducting when both the junctions are reverse biased. Okay, and this region is called as the cutoff region. Okay, try to remember these two regions that were plotted on the characteristic of the transistor. Okay, so the saturation region, when the transistor is operating in saturation region, we say that the transistor is on. Okay, and when the transistor is operating in cutoff mode, we say that the transistor is off. And let's say this on corresponds to a one state, and when the transistor is off, this corresponds to a zero state. Okay, so in this way we can use transistor to act as a switch. Okay. So the points are that to use transistor as a switch, we will use transistor either in saturation region or in cutoff region. Okay, we will not use the forward active and reverse active mode. Okay, remember the forward active mode would be used for constructing amplifiers. Okay, and the switches can be constructed by using saturation and cutoff regions. So this is important. Okay. Now, I'll draw one circuit. Okay, and we will see the operation of that circuit. And then I will establish that the transistor is operating as a switch. Okay, so okay, you might be hearing my daughter's voice. She's crying in background. So please ignore that. Okay. This is the transistor. This is the transistor. Okay. Which transistor is this? NPN or PNP transistor? This is NPN transistor. Okay. Yeah, right. This is NPN transistor. Okay. Okay. This is N transistor, okay, and this is the base terminal, this is emitter, and this is the collector terminal, okay, and let's power supply of 5 voltage, okay, and at the, since emitter is grounded, so this is common configuration. Okay, and NPN transistor, okay, and this terminal at the base side would be used for feeding the input signal. So let's feed one input signal. Okay, let's input. So because I want to implement the digital part, so I will feed a pulse signal like this, which is having just two states, either a high or low state. It's let's say this is 5 voltage and this the lower part is 0 voltage. Okay. So we can say that when it is 5 voltage, it is kind of state 1. When it is 0 voltage, it's kind of state 0. Okay. So if this is 0, this is T by 2, and this is T. So this is 1, this is 1 complete time period. And this will repeat afterwards. Okay. So I am feeding one input signal like this, which is having an amplitude of 5 volt is a pulse signal to the base terminal of this common emitter transistor, and let's assume that the value of this RB or the base resistance is 68 kilo ohms, and this RC, that is the resistance connected at the collector terminal, is 0.82 kilo ohms. Okay. And here we are collecting the output voltage. Okay, so we will try to draw the output voltage based on the performance of the transistor, and we will see how does it comes. Okay. Yeah. So let's go for the first case. When VI is 5 voltage, that is for this duration from 0 to T by 2 duration of time, when VI is 5 voltage, okay, VCC is 5 voltage. Okay. Now in this case, the transistor would be in saturation region. How? We will see. Okay. For saturation region, I need to establish that the base emitter junction and the base collector junction should be, both should be forward biased. Okay. So can you see that this base emitter junction, what is the state of base emitter junction and collector base junction? क्या देख रही है? क्लास ले रहे हैं? जा जा ना मम्मी पास. अच्छा अच्छा रुक जा रुक जा. ओके. हाँ. So let us try to find out the biasing of these two states. Okay, in what biasing mode these two junctions are? Okay, when the input voltage is 5 voltage. Okay. So it means that when for this duration of time 0 to t by 2, the voltage that is appearing here is 5 volts. Okay, 5 voltage is appearing. 5 voltage for this duration of time. So this 5 voltage appears here, okay, and then this emitter terminal is grounded. Okay, this collector terminal is connected to 5 voltage via this RC having value of 0.82 kilo ohms. Okay, now can we calculate that look at this NPN junction, this NPN transistor, okay, this base emitter junction. And right, this is NPN. So this base is P and emitter is N. Okay. Okay. The base is P and emitter is N. Okay. And the base is connected to a positive voltage, high voltage, and emitter is connected to ground, which is lower than this 5 voltage. So can I say that this base emitter junction is forward biased? Because the P side base region is at a higher voltage as compared to N type emitter region. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So this base emitter junction is in forward bias mode. Okay. Because of this 5 voltage input at the input base terminal. Right. Now the next thing is to find out the mode of operation for this collector base junction. Collector is N type, the base is P type. Okay. Okay. So for this we should know the potential that is appearing at this node. Okay. And the potential that is appearing at this node, and then by comparing these two potentials we can say something about this collector base junction. Okay. And for calculating these two potentials, okay, we need to do some calculations. So let us find out first the value of IB that is flowing through the base terminal. Let's say this is IB, okay, and the current that is flowing through the collector terminal is IC. Okay, anyone can tell me what would be the value of IB? This, for finding out this, let us apply KVL in this loop, okay, which will start from 5 voltage and then this branch, then will travel through this junction and then will end at this ground. So it's a closed loop. It's a closed loop because this 5 voltage means what? Actually, it is like this. 5 voltage, which is connected to ground. Okay, and this is 5 voltage. So this ground are same. So it's a kind of closed loop. And in a closed loop, we can apply KVL anytime. Okay, so apply KVL in this loop, okay, in this direction, and you will find that phi voltage, okay, minus IB RB minus this is base emitter junction, okay, and we know that let's assume that this is a silicon transistor, okay, and we know that when the base emitter junction of a silicon diode is forward biased, the value of voltage that appears across this across it is, what is the voltage, knee voltage of silicon PN junction diode? 0.7 volts. Okay, so at least 0.7 voltage is required to make this base emitter junction forward biased. Okay, so the voltage that appears across this base emitter junction is 0.7 volts in the case of silicon transistor. Okay, so minus 0.7 minus 0.7 volt, okay, and the loop is complete, so this is zero. And from this equation we can find out the value of IB, the base current, that will be minus 5 minus 0.7 by 68 kilo ohm, and that will come out to be 63 microampere. You can perform the calculation, it will come out to be around 63 microampere. Okay, and once we know the value of IB here, we can find out the value of IC. Okay, and one more thing is given with this, that HFE is 125, and this HFE is nothing but the value of beta. We know that for the case of common emitter configuration, the current gain factor was called as beta. So this is the same value, beta. And what was beta by definition was the ratio of IC with respect to IB. Okay, and when beta is given as 125, and we know the value of IB, we can find out the value of IC just by multiplying IB with beta. Okay, so IC is nothing, becomes beta into IB, that is 125 into 63 microampere, and this will come out to be this will come out to be, I think, 7.88 milliampere. Okay, we are finding the value of IC because we have to find out the voltage that appears at this node. Okay, so once IC is available, we can apply again KVL in this loop, starting from VCC toward this ground. Okay, so we can apply, let's apply KVL. This was KVL, this is again KVL. This will be 5 minus IC into RC minus, okay. Let's the potential at this node we have assumed to be V naught. Let's say the output voltage is measured at this potential, okay. So whatever potential appears below this mark, that is nothing but V naught, okay. So minus V naught equal to zero, okay. IC value is known, RC is given, the value of V out will come out to be around V out will come out to be around, I think, 5 minus IC 7.8 minus 3 into RC. RC is given as 0.82 into 10 to power 3. So this 10 to the minus 3 and this 10 to the power 3 is cancelling, and this is 5 minus 7.88 into 0.82. This will come out to be, anyone just do a quick calculation, tell me. 5 minus 7.88 into 0.82.
Minus 0.4.
It's coming. Okay. Minus. Minus.
0.4. Minus 0.46.
4. 4.6. Okay.
4.6.
So we are getting a negative voltage. Okay. At this point, at this node. Okay. So V naught is known at this terminal. Next thing is to know about the potential. At this node, okay, at this, let's say, at this node, let's call this as VB. Okay, VB again, when you apply KVL in this node, in this branch, you will find out the value of VB. Okay, and you will see that the value of VB come out to be around 0.7 voltage, because this is directly appearing across this base emitter junction. Okay, and you can verify this thing. Okay. VB is around 0.7 voltage. So we have the value of voltage, okay, for VB and this VC or V naught. Okay. Now looking at the voltage at this B and C node. Okay. What is the state of this collector base junction? The collector is at a negative potential with respect to the base terminal, base node. Okay. The base node is at a high potential, 0.7 voltage positive, with respect to the collector node. So the base is higher with respect to collector. Base is P type, collector is N. So P type is connected to a higher potential with respect to N type. What is this biasing? P type.
Forward biasing.
Forward biasing, okay. So this whole thing implies that the collector base junction is also forward biased. Okay, so we have base emitter junction also in forward bias mode, and collector base junction also in forward bias mode, and it will finally imply that this, in this state, the transistor is in saturation region of operation. Saturation region of operation. Okay, so when it is operating in saturation region, we say that the transistor is fully on. The transistor is fully on, right? Okay, so this is one thing. So we saw that the transistor is operating in saturation region when the input voltage is 5 volts. Okay, that is between 0 and T by 2. What happens when the input voltage becomes zero between T by 2 and T? What will happen? So when this is made zero voltage, this is also zero voltage. Look at here. Zero voltage means it's simply connected to ground. Okay, it's not, we are not applying any external voltage. So zero means the base is connected to simply ground. The collector is also connected to ground. So there is no potential applied between base and emitter. So basically, we are not applying any external force, and hence there would be no current flowing in this loop. Okay. So if there is no current flowing in a diode, means that it is acting in off state. It is in reverse bias mode. it is not conducting, it is off. Okay, so the base emitter junction is off and the value of base current is zero because we are not applying any external voltage, it's simply zero. Okay, and when IB is zero, IC automatically becomes zero. When IB is zero, IC automatically becomes zero. Okay, so IC also becomes zero. IC also becomes zero. So basically, there is no current that is flowing in the transistor when input is zero voltage. Okay. So this junction is also cut off, operating in cutoff mode. This junction is also not conducting. This is also operating in cutoff mode. Cutoff mode. Okay. And when both of the junctions are operating in cutoff mode, we say that the transistor is off. It is not conducting at all. It is not conducting at all. Okay. Now, when the transistor is in cutoff mode, what is the value of V out? What is the value of V out? Okay, we can apply again KVL in this loop, starting from VCC towards ground in this loop. So apply KVL, that is 5 minus IC RC minus V naught equals to zero. Okay, because IC is zero, so this term will become simply zero, and V out would simply come out to be 5 voltage. Okay, so the value of output voltage is 5 volts when it is operating in cutoff mode. The value of V naught is minus 0.46 volts. Okay, when it is operating in saturation mode. Okay, so we can plot plot the output voltage. We can plot the output voltage. Okay, we can plot the output voltage. The output voltage V naught when input was 5 voltage, it was coming up to a negative voltage. Look why it's negative voltage. Okay, so it will actually start somewhere from here, right? Somewhere from here. Okay, from 0 to T by 2, like this. And then when it is in cutoff mode, the output is 5 voltage, so it's going to 5 volts. 5 voltage value, like this. Okay. Now here, anything that's below zero can be assumed to be simply zero. Anything smaller than zero is nothing for us. Okay. So we can say that the output voltage is again coming in binary form. Once when it is zero, and once when it is one. So high voltage, when it's coming as high voltage, let's assume that this is in one state. And when it's coming in around zero or less than zero, we say that this is nothing but zero state. Okay, so in this way, we can use transistor. I have shown just a small example taken from the same book, that is Ball State. Okay, and you can read the portion again from there. That is explaining that with the help of this diagram, we can use transistors as a switch. In this case, okay. So the transistor can be used as a switch as well as an amplifier, okay, as well as an amplifier. And we had seen these things with the help of small examples. Okay, I encourage you to go through that section in the Ball State book. Okay. And if you find any problem, then you can always contact me. So with this, this topic is complete. The transistor as a switch. Okay. Then we will move to the next topic, that is about the introduction to power amplifiers. Okay. If you have any doubt, you can can tell me. Introduction to power amplifiers. Okay. Since this is introduction part, so we will not go into the details. We will just look at the things from an overview point of point. That how does the things, what are the things, and what are the benefits, and what is the circuit, and where it is used. Okay. So basically, the name suggests that since these are power amplifiers, so the main thing here is to deal with power. We want to increase the power as much as we can, because these are power amplifiers. So they will amplify the power. Okay. So these power amplifiers amplifies which factor? Power factor. Okay. And by definition, what is the power? Power can be, power is defined by the multiplication of voltage with current value. Okay, so if your power is increasing, you can very well assume that the voltage and current, both powers are increasing. For a general, in a general sense, we can assume there is an amplification in voltage as well as there is an amplification in current, and then we say that okay, there is an amplification in power. So output power is always higher than the value of input power, and we say that the power is amplified. And the amplifiers which are able to give us this power amplification factor, okay, are called as power amplifiers. Okay, so by definition, what is a power gain? The value of the ratio of output power with input power. Input power. Okay. So these are the circuits which are designed to provide power gain. Just some points. So these are designed to provide power gain or to handle large signals, because large signals contain more power. Okay. And why are these power amplifiers required? Because if you think about the actual practical transducers, okay, because many times the signals are coming from some sort of transducers. Okay, the transducers are nothing but the devices which convert one form of energy into another form. Okay, so let's say antenna is a kind of transducer, which is converting electromagnetic energy into electrical energy. Okay, microphone is a kind of transducer, which is converting microphone converts the voice signal into electrical signal. Okay, like that. Okay, but the problem is that the output that these transducers produce are of small magnitude, very small magnitude, in the range of few millivolts. Okay. And hence there is a need to amplify these small outputs that are coming from these transducers, because with those small value of outputs you cannot operate electronic circuit. So electronic circuit need somewhat bigger values of signals. And in many cases, it is desirable. It becomes essential. Why it becomes essential? Because let's take for the example of a loudspeaker. Okay. So you have a gathering of, let's say, around 100 or 200, 500 people. Let's say 500 people have gathered for a function, for a program. Okay. And you want to address these 500 people simultaneously in real time. So you need some power you need to have some you need to produce some sort of power that can operate that loudspeaker so that it can produce a powerful voice signal which is audible to this 500 people. For these kind of applications, these power amplifiers are very handy, very very useful. And so this loudspeaker is a very very good practical application of power amplifiers. Okay. So, and this give or operate with some tens of watts of power. Tens of, for this case, tens of watt. The unit of power is watt. The watts of power is handled by these loudspeakers. Okay. Now we will see the different kinds of power amplifiers. So generally, it is there are many kinds of power amplifiers. We will see only three types of these. Okay, and then we will just move. We will just see the things. We will not go into the detailed explanation of the functioning of these amplifiers. So these power amplifiers are actually categorized according to the amount the output signal varies over one cycle of operation. Okay, for a full cycle of input signal, full cycle of input signal. Hey, students, do you have a class after at 4 p.m.?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we are left with 5 minutes only. Okay. Fine. So, so the power amplifiers are actually categorized according to the amount of output signal. Output signal. Okay, that varies over one cycle of operation. Okay, one time period. One time period. Okay, for a full cycle of input. And what does this mean? We'll see. So suppose the first case. Let's class A power amplifiers. Class A power amplifier. Okay. In this case, the output signal varies for a full 360 degree of the cycle. Okay, that is the complete, that is complete cycle, complete signal is present with for such power amplifiers. Okay, and it will reduce with the when we go to class B or class C amplifiers. We will see that in class B amplifiers, the output is present only for the 180 degree or just half of the time period, and it reduces when we go to class C amplifiers. Class C amplifiers. Okay. So just for illustration purpose, I can draw that for the case of class A amplifiers. Okay, if this is output voltage plotted with respect to time, okay, there would be one maximum power supply, okay, level which is given to the circuit for biasing purpose. Okay, and in any case, the signals present in the circuit will not exceed that power supply level. Okay, that is actually the maximum supply level. This is power supply level. Okay, and see that for any duration of time, you operate that transistor, that amplifier, the signal should not, will not go beyond this level. Okay, and this is the same power supply which is used for biasing the transistors, okay. VCC or like that. Okay, so if for any amplifier, the signal, output signal is like this, that which is it is, this is the class A DC bias level, DC bias. Biasing is the same thing that we had seen, that to make transistor operate in a certain state, that in active region or saturation or cutoff region. Okay, so if the transistor is biased such that the level is somewhere in between maximum power supply and zero, okay, and this full 360 degree output swing is available. This is the general case. Okay, most of the time you will see the output like this. Okay, that you will get the complete cycle of output signal appearing at the output terminal. Okay, and this in general sense is a class A amplifier. Okay, and but it reduces further when we go to class B or class C amplifiers. Okay, so let's see a circuit for class A amplifier. Okay, and just draw the circuit, and I will finish class A in just 2-3 minutes. Okay. Okay. So this is the BJT. Okay, this is the BJT. This is the input side. This is capacitor. This is the input signal that is fed. Okay. This is the input signal. Okay. This is the input capacitor. Okay. And this is the resistance connected to the emitter terminal. Okay. And this capacitor connected to the emitter terminal, let's call this as CE. Okay, this is ground. Okay, then these are the biasing resistors again. This one and this is R2 and R1. Okay. And our transformer is connected here. Okay. This is primary and this is secondary of the transformer. This is secondary of the transformer. Yeah, and let's say it is connected to some speaker. Let's say this is some speaker. Okay, so this is the transformer section. This is the primary, this is the secondary. And this is the power supply plus VCC, which is used for biasing this BJT. And this R1 and R2 are the biasing resistors. CN is the input to capacitance. Okay. And C is this capacitance connected at the emitter terminal. Okay. So this is a general, class A amplifier circuit. Okay, general class A amplifier circuit. Some points about this is generally the efficiency of these class A amplifiers are very less. Okay, around 25% to 50%. Okay, and hence they are not practical for large power need. Okay, so they are not practically suitable. They are not practical for large power amplification or amplifier. Okay. And generally, it will operate with 1 to 2 watts of power, which is actually less when you want to address a large gathering. Okay. So this is suitable for radios, okay, domestic radio that are present in our house. Radios, then TV receivers also can be. TVs can also be. TV speakers are also built using class A power amplifiers. Then headphones and phone amplifiers are some of the examples or some of the applications which are employing class A power amplifiers. Okay. And similarly, we will see class B and class C amplifiers in the next class. So we will, I will end the class today here, and we will resume from here in the next, class. Tell me any doubts here, and you can give your attendance in the chat box. You can write your roll number and name for attendance part. Okay. Answer. Do we have a? Hey, Abhishek, or Abhishek, can we have class tomorrow at 3?
Sir, I'll let you know by the evening.
Okay, take care. I think in one day you said that you had 6 classes. Someday like one Wednesday or Thursdays.
Yes, sir. That's why I will check the schedule and tell you by the evening.
Okay.